challenges: poverty, disease, and ignorance. And these three would recur across many African countries. What he would do was, as I point out, the first attempt at villagization between 1961 and 1963. At this point, villagization had nothing to do with socialism. His point was this: you have so many small scattered villages who need education, they need water, they need health care. We cannot build tiny schools all over or create an innumerable list of health clinics. Come together into larger villages so that we can put a health clinic, we can ensure water gets to you. So villagization in its early manifestation was more about the provision of social services than was it a model for either politics or economics. Yesterday I pointed out that Nkrumah's advisor was William Arthur Lewis. So between 57-60, we also tried to get foreign investment and all that. It is increasingly from 1960, as I've pointed out, that Nkrumah will begin to head towards state-led industrialization. In 1960, Ghana became a republic, and then it will become a one-party state. It is in 1964 that we'll pass the seven-year development plan, which aimed at setting up a socialist economy. There's a sense in which not much of it could have been implemented before Nkrumah's overthrow. And so that is a point to keep in mind. I want to move to the third section and look briefly at the theory and practice of socialism, with a focus on Nyerere and Nkrumah. Nkrumah and Nyerere were writers who put their philosophies and visions for their new nations on record. Both had encountered leftist ideas as students who studied in the United States and the United Kingdom. There are some common threads to their philosophical reflections on African socialism. Both viewed the ideological positions as central to nation building, and that the process of wielding together new nations from disparate ethnic groups and instilling patriotism required ideological education. Both viewed the independence of their countries as connected to the broader movement to liberate the entire continent from colonial rule. So under Nkrumah, all the liberation struggle leaders would end up in Accra, and it is here that someone like Mugabe met his first lovely wife, who kept him on the straight and narrow. And after Nkrumah was overthrown, they all relocated and went to Dar es Salaam. Both emphasized a revival of the cultural values of an African past, but in ways that position them for the contemporary world. Both valued economic self-reliance and non-alignment. For an articulate exposition on African socialism, however, I turn to Senghor because he writes beautifully. Senghor was an erudite, a product of the Sorbonne, and the first black African to attain the distinction of agrégé, the highest teaching diploma in France. This erudition shines powerfully in Senghor's book on African socialism, which is a real intellectual tour de force. Senghor reflected on the pattern of the ways in 1948 between Senegalese nationalists and the French Socialist Party, because the Africans came to the conclusion that French workers, together with the French bourgeoisie, were both beneficiaries of colonial rule, and that colonialism and class struggle did not necessarily align, so they parted. Let me read a section of Sengon, because Sengon was particular in defining for himself and for his party what African socialism was or was not. So he begins, "We are not Marxists," and he put the Marxists in quotes, "in the sense given the word today, insofar as Marxism is presented as a theistic metaphysics, a total and totalitarian view of the world, a Weltanschauung." So here he uses a German word. "We are socialists," and he puts that in italics. "In other words, we shall exclude neither Marx nor Engels from our sources. We shall start from their works, as from those of the utopian socialists. And we shall add to these sources the works of their successors and commentators. But we shall only retain the method and the ideas. The method to help us to analyze our situation, the ideas to help us to solve our problems." Sengon points out rightly that Marx was a philosopher who became interested in economics because of his interest in the conditions of the English working class. He states accurately that, and I quote him, "We must not consider Marx as an economist like Keynes, but as a sociologist, a philosopher," quotation close. Sengon then goes on to make an additional clarification. "We are not communists," and he puts the communists in italics, and offers theoretical and practical reasons why they are not communists. And just in case his writing had made the West excited, he points out that, "Nevertheless, we shall not be won over to a regime of literal capitalism and free enterprise. We cannot close our eyes to segregation," and here I think he's talking about the US, "although the federal government combats it, nor can we accept material success as a way of life." Sengon pronounces, and I quote him, "We stand for a middle course, for a democratic socialism, which goes so far as to integrate spiritual values, a socialism which ties in with the old ethical current of the French socialists." So I use Sengon because of his clarity in defining what they were and were not. Nkrumah believed in the dialectical method, so he's closer to being a Marxist, and how it shed light on the process of decolonization and development. But he was not an atheist. I mentioned yesterday that when he was in the US, he was a licensed preacher in the Presbyterian Church. As a philosopher with an understanding of economics, Nkrumah's primary work that sets forth his philosophy behind his approach to African socialism was his book, Conscientism, published in 1964. I know if you have tried reading it, you may have struggled with it, as has many people. Not many of Nkrumah's followers understood his philosophy, which over time came to be referred to as Nkrumahism. Kofi Baku, the Minister of Presidential Affairs under Nkrumah's government, provided a more succinct definition of Nkrumahism as, and I quote him, "a non-atheistic scientific socialism modeled on African conditions." The CIA, and I have quite a few sources from the CIA, the CIA was dismissive of Nkrumah's ideological positioning, and I quote from one CIA memo, "However, while he has a strong affinity for socialist doctrines as adapted to the African milieu, he is primarily concerned with advancing his own designs." The CIA never wrote anything nice about Nkrumah, so don't be surprised by any of this. I've given you just a little taste of what they believed in. In Nyerere, in 1967, would pass what was the Arusha Declaration. In a sense, they had decided that the attempt at villagization was insufficient. They needed to go further. What was distinctive or contrasting about Nkrumah and Nyerere was Nyerere was specific that Tanzania is poor. We don't have money. We don't have capital. If we are to have an economic development, it must be based on land. We must lead with agriculture. Yesterday I told you that Arthur Lewis gave the same advice to Nkrumah, that focus on agriculture and food farming, but that wasn't good enough. I mean, we are talking about manufacturing. You say we should do food farming. So Nkrumah ignored Arthur Lewis. By 1977, Nyerere had admitted that Ujamaa had failed. Agriculture was underperforming. Most of the factories they had were performing less than 50%. There's a sense in which, through the hard way, Nyerere came to appreciate that people are people, and people work hard when there is something to reward them with. When you tell people, come together, and when you work, if you work 8 hours or you work 4 hours, we'll all give you just what you need for your subsistence. It wasn't motivating enough to get people to work. Nkrumah went towards his state-led industries. By different counts, by 1965, we had over 53 state-owned enterprises. The record for these enterprises were also dismal. By 1965, Ghana was bankrupt. But it is a complicated situation, because somehow Nkrumah also believed that foreign aid was one of the strategies former colonial powers maintained neo-colonialism. Much of what Ghana did, Nkrumah opted to fund internally. And so the one significant project with major foreign investment was the Akosombo Dam or the Volta River project. So that is, it complicates the situation a little more. I have noted that unlike Ghana and Nkrumah, which was shunned by the Western donor community for Nkrumah's socialist policies, donor money flowed in throughout Nyerere's period in government. The international community found Nkrumah's rhetoric, writings, and politics very disturbing, and they were discomforted by his trenchant and incisive criticisms of both capitalism and imperialism. Nkrumah's advocacy of African unity and a continental government as the only safeguard against new colonialism and the guarantor of future economic prosperity threatened the close relations countries like France had with their former colonies. Nkrumah's support of liberation movements and opposition groups from newly independent countries alienated even Ghana's neighbors like Ivory Coast, Togo, and Nigeria. For many African leaders, Nkrumah could not be trusted. According to a CIA report from April 17, 1963, and I told you they never wrote anything nice about it, so let me quote them. Ghana's vain and egocentric Kwame Nkrumah is driven by his dreams of primacy in a united Africa and of a world role as a leading figure among the non-aligned states. Quotation closed. Two of the senior Ghanaian citizens I interviewed for this project had the benefit of living in or visiting Ghana and Tanzania during their socialist experiments and testified to the very different dynamics in both countries. Dr. Kwesi Botwe lived in Tanzania from 1972 to early 1975. There were more Ghanaians there, but he's a good example. And this was at the very height of Ujamaa. Dar es Salaam had become a mecca for leftist scholars, hosting a dazzling array of intellectual or international radical intellectuals who lent their support to the socialist project. They included people like Walter Rodney, who wrote How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, Reginald Green, Clive Thomas, Thomas Sentis, John Sowell, and our Nigerian friend Claude Ake, and many others. Kwesi Boche reflected on how, and I quote him, they were attracted there because Inyerere's experience of socialism was a lot more careful and more encompassing in the way it sought social transformation than even Nkrumah's. He added that there was a program at the University of Dar es Salaam that took them to stay in the mass villages over the weekends to give them a first-hand experience of villagization and to balance their theoretical discussions on campus so as to improve the experience of Ujamaa. Dr. Kwame Dankofojo, as an investment officer at the International Finance Corporation in Washington, handled the IFC's investment in the Kilombero Sugar Project in Tanzania in 1967. He also attests to how Inyerere was very practical in his approach to socialism. Issa Shivji, the Tanzanian, sees Inyerere as someone who was softer on theory and his understanding of political economy compared to Nkrumah. I argue that the international donor community could also see that Tanzania was genuinely in search of an indigenous model for economic development. And though they may have disagreed with Inyerere's policies, they seem to respect the sincerity of his endeavor and his integrity. Mwase and Ndulu comment, and I quote, "It is quite striking that even the hard control phase of Tanzania's development received quite strong endorsement by development partners, as evidenced by the large inflows of aid and official credit to fund the country's communist programs. Despite the enunciation of African socialism as the basis for government policy making, aid inflows increased significantly during the period 1967 to 1977, in both absolute terms and relative to other sub-Saharan countries. The socialist vision of Mwalimu Nyerere's presidency excited widespread admiration and support from academics and policymakers in the capitalist West." Quotation close. And reflecting the man of integrity that he was, Inyerere decided to step down in 1985, admitting that his policies had failed and that it was time for other ideas to be explored. He remained respected to the end of his life, a moral force in Tanzania. Now to my last section, where we look at NRC, and it gets interesting and a little dicey, but it's work in progress, so bear with me. Of the African socialist heads that I have researched, Nkrumah's regime was the most short-lived. Yet, the veteran Ghanaian politician Obadiah Asamoah would note in 2014 that no political leader had the bold imagination of Nkrumah when it came to development. He states that, and I quote Obadiah Asamoah, "Nkrumah was in a hurry and he had great ambition." Quotation close. Many of Nkrumah's plans that he could not implement have been resuscitated under various subsequent governments in Ghana, and those that remain dormant excite the imagination. Nkrumah not only executed the Volta project and the Akosombo Dam, he made plans for two additional dams at Pong and at Bui. As early as 1963, His government had already paid £300,000 towards preliminary work for the Bui Dam. Nkrumah began to drill for oil in Haifasin in the 1950s, and a half century later, in the same western corner of the seaboard, we become an oil exporting country. In 1962, Nkrumah got the Russians to commit to building a railway from Kumasi to Ouagadougou, the capital of Burkina Faso. The project lies dormant, but its potential is enormous. Nkrumah turned to the Far East, or to the East, for investment because he believed countries from the Eastern Bloc gave much lower interest on loans compared to the West. In his book on neocolonialism, The Last Stage of Imperialism, which is clearly inspired by Lenin, he cites foreign aid and high interest rates as two of the new mechanisms of neocolonialism. Self-reliance, a central pillar of African socialism, was of crucial importance to Nkrumah. I have noted above how Nkrumah preferred to use the cocoa reserve to fund his development projects than to solicit foreign assistance, aside from the significant investment in the Water River project. This emphasis on self-reliance, among other important parallels, is perhaps why some of my interviewees pointed to the continuities between the Nkrumah and the Champlon governments. I continue to work on these parallels, and my reflections in this section are very preliminary. Nkrumah assumed, and I mentioned this yesterday, that the men that staged the coup in January 1972 had done so in support of him, and that they would bring him back to Ghana. There were many individuals who played key roles in the Champlon's NRC in the early years, who had been prominent in the CPP, such as Kwesi Amoakwata, who had been Nkrumah's finance minister. Dennis Austin and Robin Lackham, in their book on politics and soldiers in Ghana, report that a Champlon informed them that he had been considering a military coup since 1970, so almost 2 years before the coup. But a Champlon's relative, the journalist Kwamu Jeuchem, tells a very different story. In January 1972, Lieutenant Colonel Champlon commanded the 5th Battalion, one of the most powerful battalions in the country. In one week, he was approached by two different groups, one civilian, one military, both planning to overthrow Busia. They informed the Champlon of their intention, ostensibly either seeking his support or his neutrality. A Champlon discussed this with the second in command, Major Kwame Abo and Major Kwame Ba. In almost comical fashion, they concluded, and this is better when I say it in Cree, and then I'll say it in English. Hey, no be a person, Omutunwa, any yay into there. If everyone wants to overthrow Busia, why don't we do it? The result was a bloodless coup carried out by a few people. A Champlon then called Jeuchem to inform him of what had happened. What should we do? So this is very typical a Champlon. It was Jeuchem who reached out to Kwesi Amoakwata for help. And Amoakwata would draft the very first public statement a Champlon would make. While the military were the public face of the regime, Amoakwata assembled a think tank that called itself the Discussion Group, which met weekly at the State House and provided expert advice for the NRC. Their chairman was the lawyer Joe Randolph. Dr. Jawa Apronti acted as secretary, and they had an impressive list of members that included Fifi Hesse, Kwame Ahen, Peter Ajete, Nana Kodjo Anomako, Kwame Afre, Dr. Obed Asamoah, Dr. E. Ablo, Dr. A. O. Abudu, Mrs. Maud Cordelas, T. A. Bediako, Dr. K. Frimpong, and Kwame Jerucha. This is an impressive collection. We remember the Champong government for all kinds of uncomplimentary things. Some I don't want to even mention. So now I've decided I'm going to take them a little more seriously. The guiding principle of the Champong's regime was self-reliance. The government decided to give precedence to agriculture in its policies, considering this a complete reordering of priorities, and that any new industries that were to be established would have to be connected directly to local grown products. And then they would do two things that we all remember. One was Operation Feed Yourself. The second was Operation Feed Your Industries. And I'm happy to tell you that I even reared rabbits as my contribution to Operation Feed Yourself. A champion would create the National Reconstruction Corps to replace the Workers Brigade Nkrumah had founded and that had been disbanded with his overthrow. Both focused on agriculture. Nkrumah had built Tema and Akosombo Township and developed new estates like Yaniba Estate in Osu and North Sumtresu in Kumasi. A champion built Dansuma in Accra, South Sumtresu and Buokro Kumasi in Kumasi, as well as estates in Takrade and Kepush. I could cite more and more parallels, but these should suffice. And these projects, like Nkrumah's, were funded primarily from internal sources, because through 1974, the Champong government had refused to honor Ghana's forest debts on the claim that many were spurious. You remember the other one, Yen Tia. While never calling himself a socialist, it is clear that a champion cherished the principle of self-reliance at the heart of African socialism. A champion was not an intellectually sophisticated person, but he was a very practical man, and the spirit with which he went by his early reforms was very much in consonance with that of Nyerere, the architect of one of the boldest projects of social engineering in the 20th century. A man who had a penchant for the practical and not the theoretical. Now to a very short conclusion. As I said in the beginning, Africa's population is going to double. We're going to 2.5, almost 2.5 in 2050. We will have a demographic dividend. I've also pointed out that the half century marks when most of our known mineral resources begin to be exhausted. We've been shipping raw materials for a long time, and we need to move to knowledge economies and to adding value to our products. We must include agriculture and agribusiness in our plans and find a way to make our youthful bodies not a liability, but an asset. We need the bold and transformative vision of the likes of Nyerere and Nkrumah to ensure that come 2050, we do not find ourselves in the same predicament as on the eve of independence, when our new leaders came out of decades of repressive colonial economic policies and were faced with challenges that appeared insurmountable. Thank you.